Do you have any?
Welcome to New Testament Survey BC103. So last class we covered all four gospels. So today we're going to look at the book of Acts. So even before we could begin with our session on the book of Acts, I would request one of you all to please unmute and pray.
Dear Heavenly Father, thank you, Lord. Thank you for this day, Lord. Thank you for this class, Lord. Lord, I am praying for this class, New Testament Survey, Lord. Lord, as we are going into the class, when we are discussing this Acts, Lord, Lord, please help us to understand each and everything what you want to teach us. I am giving Diana Ma'am into your hands, Lord. Please give her knowledge, wisdom to teach us and a good way to understand, Lord. I'm giving all the students who are listening online and on campus into your hands. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
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 Amen. Amen. Amen. So today we're going to begin with the book of Acts. Let me present the slide to you. Give me a minute while I present it. Okay. So everyone can see. Okay, so today we're going to start on the book of Acts or the Acts of the Apostles. So who is the author of this book? Anyone from the class? Luke was the author of this book. Any other information about Luke that we covered during when we studied the Gospel of Luke? Sorry? He was a physician? Yes. And he was also trained by Apostle Paul? Yes. So who do you think the real author of this book of Acts would have been? So, yes, we all know Luke. But then the real author is the Holy Spirit, because Luke was inspired by the Holy Spirit. As he was inspired, he started writing the Acts of the Apostle. That's why Acts of the Apostle is also known as Acts of the Holy Spirit. This book is also known as Acts of the Holy Spirit. Why was it, what's the reason behind entitling this book as the Acts of the Holy Spirit? Because every chapter in this book refers to the Holy Spirit. We see the move of the Holy Spirit. So this book is most likely to be written between 60 to 62 AD. During this time, Paul was still in prison before his trial, under the reign of Nero, included these years. So the book of Acts also covers approximately 33 years from the time of the ascension of Jesus till Paul has been in prison in Rome for about 2 years. Okay, so keeping this in mind about the author, the Acts of the Apostle is a valuable history to the early church. So much of what we know about the early church is what we get to know through the book of the Acts of the Apostles. So without this book, it is impossible for us to know the connection between the Gospels and to relate to any of the epistles in the New Testament. So only in this book, it gives us a background, or it tells us the story, what happened after the Gospels and how did the church was birthed. When the apostles fled with fear, what happened? What gave them the strength? What made them bold enough to come back together and share the gospel? So we get to know only through the book of Acts. So Vincent, that why is it important? One, to know the outcome of the gospel. How did the gospel reach to the end of the earth? So in the gospel, we see, when we read Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, we see Jesus as a corn of wheat who falls to the ground and dies. That's what has been narrated when we read John. Can I request you all to please turn to John chapter 12, verse 24. Can I request one of you all to read John chapter 12, verse 24?
Most assuredly, I say to you, unless a grain of wheat falls into the ground and dies, it remains alone. But if it dies, it produces much grain.
Yes, absolutely. It says, most assuredly, I say to you, unless a grain of wheat falls into the ground and dies, it remains alone. But if it dies, it produces much fruit. So here it reflects about Jesus. Second, we also see the book of Acts gives us the result of Jesus' willingness to lay down his life for us so that there's much fruit has been brought forth from the ministry of Jesus. And the third, we see there's a conclusion to the gospel. So in the gospel, we see Christ paid a price, okay? He purchased the church through his precious blood. So in all four gospels, we see that Jesus died on the cross. He paid a price to purchase each of us. We are the church, okay? He purchased the church with his blood. And in the book of Acts, we see the church rises to actual existence. So who is the church now? We are the church. We are the church. And in the Gospel of Acts is where it says that the church came into existence. How? In the Gospels, we read, Jesus came, he shared the good news, he shared about the kingdom of God, kingdom of heaven. He turned the people's heart. People repented, turned away from their sin. They received the message of what Jesus was teaching and preaching. What did Jesus do? Did he end there? He made a sacrifice. He was that sacrifice. He laid down his life for us. So what he did? He laid down his life. He purchased each of us. Christ purchased us, the church, with his blood. And in the book of Acts, we see the church is we rise to actual existence. So what are we doing? We see, after the death of Jesus in the gospel, we see that, you know, the disciples were so fearful, they actually fled. Some of them went back to their work. The fishermen's basic, what they knew. All they knew was to fish. They went back to their work. But then what happened? Acts chapter 1 and 2, we see they were filled with the Holy Spirit in chapter 2. They all were so fearful, they all gathered together in the upper room. And they started to pray. They tarried, they waited there for the comfort of the Holy Spirit to come. What happened? Holy Spirit, on the day of Pentecost, the Holy Spirit came upon them. Those who were so fearful to speak, now they spoke in boldness. Peter spoke in boldness in front of 3,000 people. And all the 3,000 people could understand in their own language. How did that happen? The Holy Spirit moved among them to give them the understanding. And that to their testified saying, these are Galileans, fishermen, people who are illiterate. And they are teaching and there's wisdom in their words. And we could understand in the way, in our own language. How did that happen? Because there was move of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit was so tangible there, he enabled them to understand their own language. People were amazed to see the boldness of these fishermen, of these Galileans. So in the gospel, we see Jesus gives this famous prophecy stating in Matthew 16:18. Okay, Matthew chapter 16, verse 18, he just says that, you know, I will build my church. And in the book of Acts, we see coming to pass. We see the fulfillment of that prophecy. How? Because we are the people, we are those living stones that Christ spoke of. So we are the church. And in the Gospels, we see Christ issued the commands to his followers to take the gospel to the ends of the earth. And in the book of Acts, we get the glimpse of it, where the Holy Spirit descended upon each one of them, and each one carried the gospel, and they moved into the world to share the gospel. And the book of Acts is also the introduction to the epistles. Because without the book of Acts, I'm sure none of us can understand what Apostle Paul was writing. Who's Apostle Paul? First, we need to know, because he was never shared. The Gospels, all four Gospels, we never heard about Apostle Paul. Never talk about, he's not one among the 12 disciples. So who is Apostle Paul? Without the book of Acts, we wouldn't have known who is this great apostle. Why is he writing so many letters to different churches? So there is something missing. So the book of Acts helps us to understand the identity of this birth of this apostle. So it gives the background and occasion for much of what will follow. It also helps us to understand the epistles in the historical context. Having said that, let me change the slide so that we will go through. All 28 chapters of the book of Acts. Okay, let's look into this graph. So here the book of Acts focuses on two things. Chapter 1 to 12 focuses on the foundation of the church. And chapter 13 till 28, we see the founder of churches. It talks about two main apostles, Peter and Paul. Well, Peter writes to the Jews of Jerusalem, covering about 2-year period from AD 33 to 35. Says, okay, these are the approximate dates. And then we see Apostle Paul writing to Gentiles and to the uttermost parts of the earth, covering about 14-year period. So in between them, we see Philip writes to the Samaritans, to the Judea and Samaria. And that is a period of 14 years. It covers a period of 14 years. But overall, the author of this book is Luke, who was a doctor. Well, each chapter talks about chapter 1 to 4, talks about the spirit of the church. Chapter 5 to 7 talks about the growth of the church. 9, 8 and 9 talks about the persecution of the church. 10 to 12 talks about the expansion of the church. Well, when it talks about Apostle Paul, it gives us a clear picture of how Apostle Paul carried this gospel, went to different places, that is on his 3 missionary journey, first, second, and third missionary journeys. And it also narrates the story about how Apostle Paul was arrested and the trials that he went through, and at the end, the imprisonment of Apostle Paul. Okay, with that, we will move on. So we just went through the first one, the book of Acts. Acts as a bridge connecting the Gospels and the Epistle. And the second point we see here is the book of Acts is a book of practical theology. Why do we make the statement? Because Acts establishes the foundation truth and principles of the church in its word and in its deed. It also illustrates the life the application of all the doctrines that is outlined in the epistles. We also see in the book of Acts some things that have been birthed as a church. So what has been birthed? Anyone? Something new that has been birthed that we learn in the book of Acts. The move of the Holy Spirit. Yes. So through the move of the Holy Spirit, what has been birthed? Sorry? Francis, I didn't get, sorry. Anyone? Divine empowerment? Yes. Anyone? Praying in tongues, move of the Holy Spirit, evangelism, where they carry the gospel, go to different places, and as Rin said, ministry of the Holy Spirit, and as, and we also see the missions where the apostles pray and they carry the gospel to different places. We see Barnabas and Apostle Paul carry the gospel in their first missionary journey. And the second missionary journey, we see Apostle Paul and Silas go together. And then Barnabas and John Mark go together. Different people carry the word and go on different missions. And we also see the birth of church. Church planting is happening wherever Apostle Paul went, he planted churches. So there's church planting that is happening. Anything else? We also see the leadership being developed in the church, where we see, they appointed seven leaders, like, you know, Stephen, they appointed, they gave some criteria. Those who are filled by the Holy Spirit need to be appointed in different roles in the church. So we see there's a administration or there's a church leadership being birthed, or the ministry teams have been appointed, we can say. Anything else, something new that has taken place in the book of Acts? What happened in the upper room? They all came together for what? To pray, isn't it? So there was a prayer life was established in the church. So there was a prayer life. What else? There was, discipline. There was something called discipline and raising up of leaders was taking place. These are some things that we see that was birthed in the book of Acts. So with that, we'll move on to the third point. The third point says, the book of Acts is a book of beginning. Book of Acts is a book of beginning because there are many things that began, like the move of the Holy Spirit, the preaching of the gospel, the church was established, the word was preached, the salvation message of Lord Jesus Christ was carried and was shared in different places. So these are something new that started at the book of Acts. Then the fourth point we see here is, fourth point. The book of Acts is a book of inspiration in days of restoration. Book of Acts is a book of inspiration in days of restoration, where it provides a record of the early rain, outpour of the Holy Spirit. It also gives us a report of what God was trying to restore in the church. And also it gives us an idea, a glimpse of how apostles were moving in faith to see what God could do in and through them. And through that, we also know if the Holy Spirit can move in and through the apostles, he can also do it even through us. So this is the inspiration, the book of inspiration that inspires each of us. The fifth point here we see is the book of Acts is the only unfinished book in the New Testament. Why do you think it is unfinished book in the New Testament? Because the book does not end with an amen. No. Why do you think it does not end with that? Amen. It is still continuing. Yes, Vimal, thanks. And as it continues. Why it continues? Because the commission now is given to you and me. We have to carry the preaching and teaching which the apostle carried, the good news. It didn't end there. It continues through us. Yeah. So this is a basic question, okay? I'm not too sure if y'all also have the same kind of question in your mind. Why is the book of Acts named as Acts of the Apostle and not named with something else? Like, can be named as Acts of Peter and Paul, or it could have named as Acts of few apostles. Why do you think the book was named as Acts of the Apostles? Or it can also be named as Acts of the Believers. Or it can say the birth of the church. Any other title. Why this title? Anyone from the online, you can unmute and say or post on the chat. The basic reason is it talks about the acts, the deeds of the apostles. If you see the background of each and every apostle, or the disciples that God chose, are the weak people, the meager ones. If you see all among all 12, if you see 11 of them are Galileans. Who are Galileans? Actually, Galileans are fisher people, fishermen, a very poor area. They're not from a very posh background. Many times the disciples were addressed as Galileans, you Galileans. These are the men from Galilee. That's how they address them. Maybe the very look of them, they have been judged by that. But you see, Jesus came. There were many scholars, even during the time of Jesus, many learned people, Pharisees, scribes. Jesus never chose them. It could have made Jesus' work much easier, isn't it? If Jesus would have just chose some of the scribes, the Pharisees, some of the church leaders, the high priest. But Jesus chose some simple men, weak vessels. So it, in the book of Acts, when we read it, it clearly shares the story of how God used the weak human vessel to implement this eternal purpose. So what is that we can learn from this? Today, you and I may be weak in many areas. You and I can be looked down by others outside, just like how the disciples and the apostles were looked down upon. We may not have a very good background to talk about or stand upon. We may not have a foundation even to stand up. But then God chose us, you and I. And he says, I chose you so that I will move in and through you. I will put my word into your mouth and I will speak in and through you. I will make you as the light of the world. I'll make you as the salt and light. I'll make your voice to be heard. If people in those days could hear and be amazed of Peter's speech, Peter's sermon has transformed and changed many people's life. The same impact can happen even through us because it is the same Holy Spirit. It is the same Holy Spirit who moved through Peter and Paul is moving through you and me. And through this book, we see that Christ who did greater things through the apostles can do greater things through you and I. So we can stand upon the scripture and say, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. So the key word in this book of Acts is the apostles, which is used more than 30 times. That would have been one of the reasons why they named this book as Acts of the Apostles. Okay, Yeshua.
It is people who weren't recognized or not, and as an unrecognized.
What I want to say is that I want to talk about Saul, who was a killer, used to kill Jews, but he took him. And he made him into a great preacher who talked about Christ. Someone who's come from that bad background is come to minister about Christ. So that's what I want to say.
Yes, thanks for adding that point, Sean. Thank you. Yes. Okay. So let's talk about the purpose of this book. So what's the purpose of this book of Acts? I've listed about 7 points on your screen, if you all can see. 7 points. What are they? To preserve an historical record of the origins of the early church. We see that Luke, being a man who's educated, would be concerned that these happenings was needed, was required to be recorded for future generation. So he felt there's an important need, and he recorded everything. He starts to write. The second point we see is to demonstrate continued work of Christ through the ministry of the Holy Spirit. Can I request you all to please turn to Acts chapter 1, verse 1? Can I get one of your Bibles, please? So Acts 1:1 says, the former account I made, O Theophilus, he's writing to Theophilus, of all that Jesus began both to do and to teach. So Apostle Luke is trying to write not only to Theophilus, to you and I, that we may know the things that happened in the early days, the important things. And we also see to demonstrate the pattern by which Christ builds the church. And before that, we see to defend the church from the Roman opposition toward the Jews, because they had these religious group drift between the religious, that is the Jews and the Romans. So he's trying to record everything to showcase us the Roman Empire's opposition towards the Jews. The fourth point we see to demonstrate the pattern by which Christ builds the church. And we also see the next point, fifth, to provide a defense of Christianity in a time when worldwide persecution was foreseen. So through this book, we could demonstrate the past Roman policy of ignoring about the persecution. They persecuted the early church leaders or the early church Christians. So we understand what it means to be persecuted, and the persecution is not new in our time, but it was also present in the early days. The sixth point we see is to assist in the evangelism of the Jews by showing that Christianity is indeed the fulfillment of the Old Testament. The seventh point we see is to provide a defense brief to be presented as Apostle Paul's trial to explain his arrest and charge that were against him. So these were some of the things that are been recorded in the Acts of the Apostles, and you know, so that we understand the purpose of why the book of Acts of the Apostle was needed. Okay. So let's look into the key verse and how it is fulfilled in the book of Acts. So Acts chapter 1 verse 8 is the key verse of this book. Can I request one of you all to please read? Okay, on your screen.
Be witness to me, Jerusalem, and in all Judea and Samaria, and to the end of the earth.
So why is this verse important? Why is this verse been chosen as the key verse? Because it gives us an order to witness the book of Acts, where it gives us an order saying that you shall be a witness in Jerusalem, in Judea, Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. So whatever is written here is also what Jesus instructed in the Gospel of Luke chapter 24 verse 46. Can I request you all to please turn to Luke chapter 24 verse 46, where after the resurrection of Jesus, when he showed himself to the disciples, he instructs them, he gives them the word. Can anyone read 46 and 47?
And said to them, thus it is written that the Christ should suffer and on the third day rise from the dead, and that repentance and forgiveness of sins should be proclaimed in his name to all nations, beginning from Jerusalem.
Beginning at Jerusalem. So it should be preached in the name of Jesus to all nations, beginning from Jerusalem. You see, the same order has been given in the Acts of the Apostle. Carry the gospel, the ends of the earth, starting from Jerusalem. Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. So what are the keys to the kingdom that operates in the book of Acts? We have listed four keys. Okay, this we finished. The keys to the kingdom of God. Keys to the kingdom of God. Here we see the word of God is the sword of the Spirit. Word of God is the sword of the Spirit. We see that the word of God was central in the teaching and preaching of all the apostles, because they were totally saturated in the word of God. We see they used the word of God in the preaching and teaching, through which they exercised the exhortation, salvation. Through the word, they moved in the grace. Through the word, they shared the gospel. And we also see the second point, the word of God was a sword of the Spirit that they exercised skillfully. They moved in boldness, knowing the position, knowing the authority that they carried through the word of God. They preached and they taught the word everywhere they went. They testified the word to everyone. And because the word of God carried life, wherever they preached, Actually, they witnessed great results. There was manifestation power in the word of God because the word of God had the power. And there was a great result in their ministry because the word of God moved in power and it increased and grew and multiplied. So wherever the apostles shared the word was preached, followed by the demonstration of the power of the Holy Spirit. So how did they demonstrate? They saw healing, deliverance, signs, wonders, and miracles took place in their preaching and teaching wherever they went. Why? Because the Holy Spirit backed the word of God. They just didn't went and demonstrated the power of the Holy Spirit. No, they shared the word of God, and the word of God, the Lord backed the word of God by the power of the Holy Spirit, where signs, wonders, and miracles took place. We also see the move of the Holy Spirit during when they shared how the Holy Spirit moved in and through them. How? The ninefold role of the Holy Spirit we see in the book of Acts. We see that the Holy Spirit moved as the commander-in-chief. He was the inspirer of prophecy. We see the fulfillment of the prophecy. The Holy Spirit moved as the promise of the Father. Father promised in John 14:16, we see the Father promised that I will send a comforter and he will abide with you forever. Everything that was promised in the gospel was fulfilled in the Acts of the Apostles. Holy Spirit was the gift of God. He was the comforter of the churches. During the persecution, church were moved in fear. They were scared. But you see, the Spirit of the Lord moved among them and they were comforted. Every word that they preached was confirmed by the move of the Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit was the rain of heaven. And he was the bringer of joy in them. With that, we will also see the ninefold relationship to the Holy Spirit. How is this relationship developed? When we pray and move and yearn for the Holy Spirit to abide in us, we see this relationship move in and through us with the Holy Spirit. One is by empowered by the Spirit or by being baptized in the Holy Spirit. You see, everyone who believes Jesus as the Lord and Savior were baptized in the Holy Spirit. We see in the case of the centurion, the Roman centurion who believed, who asked for Peter to come and share the word. And when Peter came, shared the word and prayed, even before he could be part of the water baptism, he was filled with the baptism of the Holy Spirit. We see the recipients of the Spirit. We see the co-witness of the Spirit, prompted by the Spirit. Philip was prompted by the Spirit to preach the good news to the eunuch, right? So he caught up on the chariot and said, how? There was prompting. We see the prompting of the Holy Spirit. How does this prompting happen? When we develop the relationship with the Holy Spirit, appointed by the Spirit, the leaders, when they prayed, the leaders were appointed by the Holy Spirit, separated and sent by the Spirit. We see in the book of Acts how the Holy Spirit separated Apostle Paul and he sent them to different place, separated to be sent forth. You and I have been separated from what we were doing. There's something that in store for us. God is going to send us to establish his kingdom in and through us. Next point, we see being led and guided and directed by the Holy Spirit. How can one be led, guided, and directed if you do not have a relationship? That was one of the reasons why we should have this, develop this constant relationship with the Holy Spirit so that we can also be led, guided, and directed by the Holy Spirit in our ministry. The next point we see is transported by the Spirit. Just like how Philip was transported. That can happen when you have a relationship with the Holy Spirit and also being filled with the Spirit. on the day of Pentecost. All the disciples, apostles were gathered in that 120 people, were gathered in that upper room bay, filled with the Holy Spirit. So you and I, can happen anywhere, any place, and we sit in the presence of God. We have been filled with the Holy Spirit. We can have that encounter with the Holy Spirit. Most of the revivals, you see, people have been filled with the Holy Spirit. There's a tangible presence of the Holy Spirit. Constant, much beyond what they could do, the Holy Spirit can move and do. Okay, time's up. 6 more minutes. We'll see how much can we cover. Through the book of Acts, we also see the name of Jesus carried the authority and power among the believers, the Holy Spirit. Okay, there was in the name of Jesus, people received salvation. In the name of Jesus, people were delivered, they were healed. There were signs, wonders, and miracles happening in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Very simple. When Peter and John went to the temple, outside they saw a crippled man being seated. He's been seated for many years. It's not something new that happened that day. But then Peter and John noticed him. And even this person noticed them. When they made a contact, he asked for alms. In fact, he was looking at Peter's hand, the movement of the hand, where he can put it in his pocket and take some alms and give him. This was the only expectation of this person who was crippled for many years from birth, seated outside the temple. So his purpose of being seated there is to take. But what happened? Peter and John were moved by the Holy Spirit. They looked at this crippled man and said, hey, listen, look at us. Look at me. Peter says, look at me. The crippled man looked at Peter. The minute he looked at Peter, Peter just said, I do not have silver and gold, but what I have, in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk. That's it. He just said, the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. There was power in the name of Jesus. Scripture says everything in heaven and on earth and up below the earth subject to the name of Jesus. Everything will bow down. Everything will come alive. Everything will obey the name of Jesus, because the name of Jesus is above everything. Name of Jesus carries power. Not only then, even now, in our time. The name of Jesus delivers us, brings us healing. You don't have to say a big prayer to receive your miracle. We don't have to. Just by uttering the name of Jesus, you will receive what you needed. When a child cries, the mother understands why the child is crying, isn't it? Is it for hunger? Is it for stomach pain? If a mother can discern and understand, how much more our God, who created us, can understand? Just by we uttering the name of Jesus, he knows what is your need. Because the scripture says, even before a word can be formed in our mouth or our tongue, he knows it. He is all knowing. God is omniscient. He is all knowing. He knows everything. So by the name of Jesus, there's forgiveness and remissions of sin. Last is the prayer. Every prayer that we pray has power. So in the book of Acts of the Apostles, we see the continued steadfast prayer. They continued to pray. There was power in the prayer. One of the examples that we read in some of the classes, we see when Apostle Paul was stoned. What did the disciples do? they just gathered around him. Though the scripture does not say that the apostles gathered around him, the disciples gathered around him and prayed, but it says next morning Apostle Paul got up and he moved on to Derby. So what strengthened him? Prayer. All, you know, the disciples knew one thing is only to pray and call upon the name of Jesus. The Jesus who was with them physically, now he's with them spiritually. They believed on the move of the Holy Spirit. They believed, they depended solely on the Holy Spirit. They depended solely on the word that Jesus taught them. So they prayed. Every time they were in trouble, they prayed. We see Paul and Silas were in prison. What did they do? They rejoiced, they sang song, and they prayed. When Peter was in prison, what did the disciples do? They all gathered into one room and they prayed hard. When there was earnest, steadfast prayer was prayed, you see the iron doors were opened. There was an earthquake in the prison. The doors were open and Peter was out. The angel of the Lord delivered Peter from the prison and walked him through and led him out. When the disciples prayed, when Silas and Paul were praying in the prison, there was an earthquake. The iron door just broke open. And they were freed. Did they run away? No. But then through that incident, the jailer and his family were received the salvation. They preached to them. The very act of them not running away ministered to them the love of Christ. The jailer and their family was transformed. So the prayer was birthed. On a regular basis, they were praying. They prayed for different situations. They prayed for the leadership. They prayed for the ministry team. They prayed even when they departed from one place to another. They prayed. We see when Apostle Paul was leaving, the people gathered near the shore. They prayed. They sent him. They gave him a wave, a goodbye to him. They prayed for special requests when they were all fearful. You see, what did the apostle do? They all gathered into the upper room, 120 people. They prayed. And only when they prayed, there was the Holy Spirit descended upon them. And then they prayed for boldness. They prayed to receive the Holy Spirit. They prayed to raise the dead. Isn't it? They prayed for healing, deliverance. They prayed and asked, Lord, we may have the mind of the Lord. We also see the prayer was the pattern of this New Testament church. And this is the pattern that we need to implement in us, in our ministry. Because prayer is the key. It is the vital to our ministry to be birthed in. So Jesus has commissioned us after his disciples. It is our duty, it is our commission to take this gospel and carry it and we preach to the end of this world. So it is our duty. So the book of Acts does not end there. The book of Acts continues with us. We are that disciple. We are the apostles of Christ who can carry this good news, who can carry this word of God which has power, which has authority to bring signs, to bring healing, deliverance, work, signs, wonders, and miracles in our time. So can we ask the Holy Spirit, Lord, as you moved in the apostles and disciples' life, can you move in our life that we may be set forth to do what you have called us to do? Okay, so with that, we will pray. And next class, we will move on to the next book, okay, to the book of Romans, because we have covered everything that needs to be taught in the book of apostles. Okay, so let's pray. Father, dear Heavenly Father, we come into your presence with an earnest heart, thirsting for more of your Holy Spirit. to move in and through us, that we may be a witness, as you said in Acts 1:8, in Jerusalem, in Judea, and Samaria, and to the ends of the earth, that we may carry this word with power and with authority, and we will move in boldness, just the way that you wanted us to do. Thank you, Lord, for choosing us and setting us apart. We pray and we ask that you move in and through us. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you so much for joining in today's session. God bless you all next week with the book of Romans. God bless. Thank you.